I walk away from him, and then, nope, he's alive.
Unfortunate moves from Gamers 2, but maybe they can rectify them here in Game 3. Orianna, removed from Power of Evil. Gragas away from JWoww once again. Will the cast be banned? Will the Maokai be banned? There's the Syndra away from Power of Evil. Very smart choice.
Because you recommended it.
Yeah, well, I mean, it's just obvious. That was so lane dominant. Gamers 2 didn't get out of lane that time. And if it weren't for some very clutch team fights, they wouldn't have gotten out of game one either. So, learning the lessons. Nidalee still away from JWoww. So, Kassadin, as well as Maokai, still up. I don't think the Lucian was a giant threat for them here. So, I think UL are okay leading that one around.
So, here's the thing, Gamers 2. Ha!
There we go.
We got champion portraits. We're good to go.
All right. So that was going to annoy me if it was there for that game, too.
I was like, but anyway, Morgana being banned out again. Now Unicorns of Love ban Lucian, ban Maokai, leave both up and get one of them.
So in game one, G2 first pick Lucian, and maybe UL's like, we can bait that. We can give him Lucian. From what I've seen, I feel like Maokai is more important.
Yes.
I know G2 wanted it more in game one. I don't think it's as important as Maokai, though. But this is the problem for UOL. If they ban one, the other's taken. If they don't ban either, all right, which is it going to be? Because the thing is, Power of Evil doesn't play Kassadin. They ban it blue side. Wow, G2, they want Lucian over Maokai. That's an insta-lock, yeah. 3 seconds. It's all it took to type in the name and click it.
Shit. Just shows their priorities right out. I was really surprised in game one when we saw them locking in the Lucian for Yuki right off the bat.
Yeah.
Just that high of a priority for them. And then we see Unicorns of Love say, all right, this is where our priorities lie.
Yeah.
Maokai Rengar.
Okay. Well, The Rengar steal from Morden, I think, is fine. Gilius had, I would say, a hit and miss Rengar.
He had a miss Rengar early game, and then his late game was really good. His capitalization on positioning and his ultimates near the end of the game were really good and tricky.
Yeah, that's true. They really were. So if UOL can pull that one final trick up their sleeve, they'll be in good shape. And, of course, Rengar did help in both series today, actually, the mid lane snowball. So that is an important match for these guys. I'm fine with Rattle picking Thresh here. The tanks were good for him, but the Thresh picks were really good as well. And wow, it's going to be the third time in a row, Aurelia versus Maokai here. Second time that JWoww will be the Aurelia side on this.
Yeah, I mean, I guess he's confident in his play on Aurelia versus the Maokai. He was bullying Vizichachi around more than Vizichachi was bullying him around when he was playing Aurelia.
True.
So JWoww's Aurelia seems to be on a higher level in this matchup against Maokai. He almost killed him a couple times. He almost had assistance killing him and picking him off.
Yeah.
I'm actually a little confused here as to why Rydal didn't end up going for the Alistar, because I really, really loved that pick on him. I loved that pick on him. But the fact that he's going to go with the Thresh means that he has other things in mind in terms of what he's going to do in lane to pick people off. Because, God, was his Alistar play good. Like, he's just going to flash forward, pulverize, and then headbutt somebody into the turret.
Yeah.
Or headbutt, pulverize a team. Like, now he doesn't have that same playmaking ability. He has more of a pick ability and with some playmaking follow-up. Like, granted, Thresh is a playmaking support, and I enjoy Rydal on those types. But I feel like he's not as tanky as Rydal wants to be as a player.
Well, we got to see, though. Yeah, and you're right. He has been putting himself in the front line just by default. It's just a matter of what kind of things you can play around, what you can do well. Just keep in mind, if Gamers 2 just blows people up, who needs to be a tank if they all die before they can deal damage to you? Maybe that's what G2 can rely on. Same comp exactly for Unicorns of Love as the previous game. They'll need a new mid laner as Syndra's banned. Gamers 2 going to do something very similar as well.
Are they going to go exactly the same comp,
wow,
too?
Wow. Lucian instead of Trist. You all need a new mid laner. Otherwise, the exact same as game 2. This does give G2 better early game power. Keep in mind, Yuki and Rydal won the early lane with Tristana. They get Lucian in here, that should be even better for them. So, G2 might be able to snowball an early game lead off this.
Yeah, here's the thing. If JWoww could get some kills on that Maokai early in the mid game, like he could have had last time, which is just kept slipping through his fingers, and if they can set Yuki up to just dominate the lane and not let up that pressure, then the utility will actually be really good on him.
Yeah.
In terms of what Ocelot will give. But otherwise, it's going to be a very
weird situation.
Ooh.
AP. Kog'Maw, baby.
So Faker just whipped this out today, earlier today in OGN. I think he won a game, and I think he lost a game with it. So it's actually extremely strong. I don't remember who I was playing with, but it was an ARAM game. Mm-hmm. It was like, wow, AP Kog'Maw is ridiculous.
Yes,
and I was like, yeah, we kind of don't balance it around AP Kog'Maw because there's no reason to because he's not played and he doesn't have a lot of strengths to him.
There was actually, so back in the day, the big AP Kog'Maw player was Froggen. And eventually caught up on everyone else as well, and it became more popular
too,
pick.
For a while.
Yeah, well, this is way back. This is even before. And basically, the mana cost cap on the ultimate went up from, I think it was like 5 stacks to 10 stacks, like 400 mana ultis. And that made AP Kog disappear. People were like, you know what? Yeah, we're just going to hop off. The end game spam is a little bit too expensive. And then it's come back recently. Yeah, Zamfira ever since then played it a little bit as a North American Challenger player. We saw him in the spring promotion tournament on Cognitive Gaming.
A while ago, yeah.
Yeah, last year's spring promo tournament. And then also, yeah, we've seen Faker play it in now 2 consecutive rounds of NLB, quarters and semis. I think 3 games total now. And
I guess it's not OGN. I guess it is.
Different TV station.
Yeah.
And everything. So, that is a champion we're seeing come back a little bit, and it's kind of fun to see. Like mid Zillion came back as well. Support Zillion was around as well. I want to see how it plays out. I have not gotten a cast in AP Kog'Maw in a long time. Funny story about AP Kog, by the way. So back on old Evil Geniuses /CLGEU, Frog and Wicked, that whole crew. I guess when he was playing AP Kog, Froggen wouldn't watch his own champion. He would move his screen to the edge of the range of his ultimate. And he would rely on his teammates, Krepo, Wicked, etc., to tell him when he was diving past turrets. He'd be like, back up, you're going to take turret aggro. They would spot the champion for him. He would only look at the artillery.
Wow.
So I don't know if that's how it's being done here, but did you know?
Well, we'll have to see, because I'm really excited to see how this pans out. Because AP Kog'Maw, he has some fallbacks to him. He has some like definite weaknesses.
Mm-hmm.
Mana issues is one of them. The second one is the fact that he's very vulnerable.
Yes.
And the fact that he also is very skill shot reliant. So I wonder what his build is going to be, because maybe he might sneak an Ashes Tooth in there. We'll see.
Yeah, it's true. You can hybridize. I mean, heck, you could also just do AD Kog'Maw. Like, to be completely fair.
That is
it's not even a guarantee that's going ability power.
Because it is Braum. It is a Maokai.
Mm-hmm.
You could definitely sneak an AD Kog'Maw into there.
Yeah, like you could straight up run a double AD comp. Yeah. Heck, I don't even realize. I don't think they swapped, but I like just started talking about Kog'Maw right away.
Okay,
because like they could theoretically lane swap that Corki mid Kog AD carry. Like that's fine. That's an acceptable comp as well. Corki used to be a mid laner for a little while. Oh. People would run it against Orianna specifically, actually.
That's right.
The matchup they wanted. Then just season 1, it was mid AD carry, so whatever. So that's a good long time ago. You know, 3.5 years or so. But you've got a great poke advantage. You've still got wonderful team fight. The funny thing is you've still got this really great Maokai frontline. Rengar can still dart around there. You've still got the Maokai Braum together in general, which is all kinds of scary. It is AP Kog. There's a Doran's Ring. Also went Flash Ghost.
Yeah, so he can just reposition himself during the Living Artilleries
and
continue the aggression. I like that summoner spell choice there. And he's going to need as many escapes as he can possibly muster.
So let's see what we can get here.
Starts with the...
Yes. So my understanding of AP Kog is you max E first.
Wave clear.
Yeah, it's really good wave clear. Has no fall off. 260 base damage at max rank or 280, one of the two. And a decent ratio. I think it's like 0.7 or 0.8. Last I checked, you maxed Q second. Some didn't even put points in the W into Biohazard Barrage, the auto attack spell. But yeah, it could be more of a Kale type build where it's like Gnasher's Tooth, Lich Bane, and you're really auto attack reliant. I guess more of a hybrid build. But also I've seen Tear, Rod of Ages, and you're very much reliant on the mana pool, so you can spam your ultis out.
He's very monogated.
Yes, very, on his ultimate. Did you know, on Kog'Maw, the ultimate it has a damage amp against champions. Only the base damage is amplified.
By 75%?
125%. It has 2.25x the base damage. AP ratio is still 1 to 1. It doesn't scale any harder against champions. It's only a base damage increase.
means that even just regular AD Kog'Maw
benefits
from that.
If you're going for a mana build, you're basically doing AD Kog'Maw's ulti damage. Except for the fact that you'll have some Magic Pent, which is a big scaler there.
That's true. That's definitely true.
So Borden with a very tiny leash is going to get his blue buff. Gilius also starts topside. He's going to have his red here. And there's the bottom lane. Lucian against Corki. Their same supports as last time, though. Illusung forced to use both charges for sustain already, and the push lead is here for gamers, too.
And both teams are going to have to fight for their lives on this one, because one of these teams, your months of work,
down.
The other one, you're going to be playing in the semifinals and have more chances. Really, really big. This one game, it is this game that will decide.
It is absolutely this game. And we have begun the laning phase. So far, we are close between these two teams. 6-7 CS, level 2. Still not there for Vardak. I don't know why he wanted that one, though. Big damage comes through from Yuki. They were down a level. That was a silly trade.
Yeah, it's really just back and forth there. But he ends up with such low HP, he has to blow his potion so early on in this matchup. They end up getting the level 2 pretty late.
Yeah.
But man, that is not a situation you want to be in that early on.
It could just be nerves, or could be anything, but it's not the right start to that lane. I mean, you get Lucian now instead of Tristana. You know that lane's going to be stronger, and one mistake could ruin your day. Of course, quick pause here, as you can see by the screen that says game pause, 3 minutes into the game. And really, nothing big has changed so far. The one difference, though, I think it's going to be really massive, is since that Syndra ban, Unicorns of Love now do not have a lane bully. They're running the AP Kog'Maw mid. This changes the landscape of the game significantly. Because now Lulu is actually going to have some damage. So late game Lulu is not a big damage threat. Mid game Lulu is. The AP ratio hit is on the slow on her Q. And basically the duration of the speed buff on her W is lower. But her damage didn't go anywhere. So her like level 13 max Q max E is still the same damage you've always had. And I mean, two damage spells are two damage spells. It's decent damage there.
Yeah, the fact that Ocelot's going to be up against that Kog'Maw might be a little bit of a gimmicky play.
I think the boon for G2, though.
Yeah, I think it's going to be able to work out for them if they play it correctly. He is going to have the lane bully over the Kog'Maw early on, but I think Gilius is going to want to make some visits here.
Oh, he just got visited by Morden, though. He's not going to get his way in here just yet. Level 3 on both junglers. He's taking the wolves, but Morden once again stalking his prey. There's a ward down. Gilius does not have smite yet.
Tried to caustic spittle him there.
Oh, Hillsong misses that CS though. Cannon minion goes to waste. 19-8 in CS right now. His Lucian pick is crushing Unicorns of Love. Morden, I believe, just stole away the big wolf.
Yes, he did. He ended up getting the big wolf for himself with his smite. But man, Vardag's taking more damage in this bot lane. He's level 2. His support's level 3. He missed some EXP.
He's getting closer up in this gold, though. Looks like they're all pretty close to getting last hit under turret. So 15-21 was the score before that wave. Is not completely horrible, but it is definitely a deficit. Early recall forced away from Vardag. He will be so late to level 6. It's not a good place to be.
This is the lane bully. This is why you first pick the Lucian for Yuki. And it's paying off for gamers, too. He's actually not going to completely back, so there's going to be more harassment coming out.
Song taking even more damage. I like this play with the Gatling gun. He's setting up the minions pretty properly. Gets the entire wave. Now he's going to recall as down 6 minions. That's not horrible. He'll be able to get an extra Dorns and maybe a couple of potions. That's what I would buy if I were him, if he could afford it. He's staying. Again. Vardax is staying again.
His support actually backed.
Well, it gives him Targon's Brace, which is extra sustain. He'll have twice as many charges to try to feed health back in. And actually, wow. So Yuki's going to recall back. This will give Vardox time to heal back up and have a decent shot at this lane.
No, they actually aren't going to back.
Okay, yeah, they saw you came back in. If that Corki was gone, you recall there and you keep your item lead. Because you can't be a lane bully, give your opponent an extra Dorans, and then still bully out. And then once they saw him, they said, you know what, never mind. We can't do that after all. But you can see it's a 13 minion deficit or so. So it's not exactly great for Bardock.
Speaking of minion deficits, about 13 up top as well. JWoww's going to have to hit all of these. Pick him up for himself over the Maokai, who's been having some good success all series long.
Maokai's won pretty much
every game
here. Yeah.
Every game today. Coming into 4-13 with the Gragas nerfs. I knew the Maokai was going to be strong, considering on 412, people were starting to pick him up. Now, he's just ridiculous. The fact that you can't really play a whole lot into him, kind of had to play around his style. And when he shows up for the fights, well, you got to deal with him before that.
One thing that's so good about him is that he has such good self-peel for all the diving. If there were more ranged bullies, like I feel like Nidalee would do well, and I feel like Kennen would actually do pretty well
here. Yuki took it.
Ooh.
So they allow
him... Pickaxe Doran's. It's good.
Yeah, they allow him to back to keep his item advantage because Vardags went and got himself a pickaxe. I mean, sorry, a Doran's blade and longsword. Mm-hmm. Whereas Yuki got the pickaxe.
Yeah, with a CS lead, about 18 is a difference of 15 AD right now on the items, which is a pretty big deal. Thankful thing for Vardags, though, is his combine only costs about 940 from this point. Or I think it's 1040 from longsword.
Yeah. Warden's gonna get some vision of the area and counter jungle. While Gilius clearing out that mid.
Warden will take the big wolf. It's gonna be a decent amount of time for him. Power of Evil gets back into the lane. Second Doran's ring and a tier. Pink Ward's gonna get swoop. Nope. He lives!
Yep.
She lives, sorry.
She. Yes. Don't say those things about Samantha.
Samantha?
Named every ward.
What's that one?
Bobby.
What's that one?
Joshua.
Joshua?
Yeah.
Jat Leesman?
No. Yes, kill that ward.
Wow. No. You are hostile.
I'm just kidding.
You called me a dog torturing pound.
It's dog pound torture.
Oh, right.
Yeah.
Close enough.
No. I'm sad that
now
that
you want Jat to die.
No, I'm sad that ward will expire in 3 minutes.
Sure you are.
It's the wisest ward I've ever known. Look at how much vision it's giving.
I'm up against the wall, losing half its vision radius? Great. So you're saying its potential is wasted? Is that what you're saying? Ilisong, gotta be careful though, getting knocked around a little bit. He is level 5. Ulti is coming up soon-ish in this lane. I want to see if Yuki can actually use this AD lead. 21 minions right now, the disparity in the bottom lane. Gilius waiting for the blue buff respawn. There it is, Power People.
He needs this.
Would love to have this blue buff.
Kog'Maw needs blue buff. You can see how much mana he's willing to just throw down on it in order to get himself some tier stacks. So that's going to help him on his way to that.
So interestingly, Rydal actually went to Max Flay first. He's got 3 points in that spell. Does help him last it with Targon's Break, so I do understand that choice. Another hook on a Hillisong, though. Good damage. Puts a slow on a Yuki, though. He wants this fight. I think he's going to get enough damage down, though. Jumps back to Corki. Good fossil bomb trade, though. Rydal pulls him back in. Vardox half HP.
Level 6 for Yuki.
And back up. Yuki, good culling right there. Hillisong going to tank it. Only misses one pellet. Nice shot.
Yeah, all of them but one. It was a really good trade there. Yuki hitting the 6 and immediately abusing it and using it. Now Rydal is very close to level 6 himself. Hillisang actually hits it first.
He got a lot of solo XP. Corki was gone for a while.
Ooh. If you can get a kick on a Kog'Maw,
yep.
It'd be pretty great. Look at this wave clear he has from the caustic spill. Not the caustic spill, the void ooze. Mm-hmm. Blah, they all have to do with blah, 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 blah.
That tier blue buff, man, it's going pretty well for him. 4 points in the E, 2 points in Q. Does have one in Bio Arcane Barrage, just to be sure. There's the pink ward sweep by Morden and Ocelot.
He saw that one.
Yeah, you did.
One on the other side that's still alive.
It's okay. You feel like you would like felt it brush against his skin. You couldn't see it, you know?
The ward?
Yeah, like when he went down the other brush. It's like, there's something weird and pink in this brush.
Stub your toe on it.
Yeah.
Yep, Gilius found himself a ward.
Bam.
Actually just uses ferocity on it immediately.
Wanted to kill it and get out there. You gotta be always careful. Ooh, hook on the Hillisong. Gonna put the Unbreakable down. That Rocket's gonna miss, though. Q Harass still hits Yuki, but he's getting sustained up quite nicely with the Doran's and the Targon's Brace here. We are staying at about a 25-minute deficit that is slightly growing for Yuki still, but not really shattering wide open anymore. Warden goes for the ward hop, looks for a way in behind Kog'Maw without getting spotted by a ward.
Power Evil placed a ward inside of that bush earlier, so he might have a false sense of security here. Warden comes from behind.
Oh my gosh, here comes Lee Sin. Power of Evil, though, he's only going to be in this lane for a very short amount of time. He sees him. Q's going to land. Yeah, early flash. You've got to do that.
Yep, got the flash from him. Good job there. Maybe a repeat gank in the future will be able to allow him to pick that one up for his team. But now, duel in the top lane.
And it's Visichachi trying to push around JWoww. CS really close between the two. 100 to 90 right there with the wave still up there. Does not push the shield on. Yuki's got to be a bit careful. More Foster Spawn harass. Health bar is actually higher for UOL now, but big damage. Flashplay only catches Bardock's. And here's the TP. Can they win the fight in the bottom lane? Unicorns of Love going to cancel that one.
Oh, but Morden is here as well. He has his flash. There's a pink ward in it, so he knows that he's safe to come in from the side.
All right, Rydal, can you make the play? Hillisong does have exhaust and ulti. Bardock's has flash, but no heal. Visichachi really not afraid of JWoww whatsoever, but does have a teleport cooldown. Yeah. Gamers 2 could use that to take Dragon, probably.
Morden passes by Samantha. Oh, he sees her.
That's a different one.
Is that not?
No, oh, it was in the bottom lane.
What?
Wait, no, never mind.
I know the names of my wards.
What's the one in Bottom River?
Bobby.
The pink ward.
Oh, the pink ward. I never named that one.
There she is.
Give her a name, freak.
Carla.
It's a beautiful name for a beautiful baby girl.
What? That ward's old. It's like 5 minutes old. Hey,
congratulations, freak.
It's a full-grown adult. It's a full-grown adult ward. Pay her own college.
Ah. Ward College.
Barista at Starbucks.
Oh, God. Hey, man. There's a lot worse things you could do. Pay yourself through college.
Yeah, yo, Yuki. Nice. Stay safe. Ocelot does steal away this Wraith, though. He's going to stay
nice
and happy. Visichachi going to go ahead and cut this wave down, proxy it up, nice and happy.
Cutting the wave is Maokai. He's got that sapling wave clear. He actually bullied JWoww so hard, he had to run to his tier 2 turret to be safe.
So Visichachi, man, he's warming up for this matchup, though, doing a really nice job. TP by JWoww basically gets this wave back. He missed, I think, like a minion.
Wow.
Basically, of the extra wave, but it also gives Visichachi time to walk back to his lane without missing much.
He also got himself a Rod of Aegis and some wards. So this is really big for Visichachi. The fact he has that Rod of Aegis so early on, by the 13-minute mark, is actually really good for him. 125 CS, 13 minutes in. Ridiculous for a top laner.
Doing very well for himself, man. And this Aurelia pushed into the turret. Only is going to miss a minion or two, and Visichachi will have teleport first. Only about a minute away on that one, whereas JWoww has closer to 3.5. That is something that Unicorns of Love could play around in the next minute or so. And they're... see what they're setting up for.
Gilius has 5 Ferocity. He has his ultimate available. If he makes a gank down bottom, it could tilt this matchup and be exactly what they needed.
They know Morden near the bottom side, but not too close just yet. Can they get on in? There's the root landing onto Rydal. Box comes down. Big burst though as well. Ulti in, and Hillisong grabs first blood, puts the shield up, and Yuki gets nothing back.
Yuki just getting some damage down. They might go for a dragon here off of that play, but Gilius is a little low. So I don't know if they would be able to do it. They are going to ping it, though.
Morden just grabbing his red buff. The pings go down towards dragon, and Gilius is going to aggro that. Morden around in the wings, and there comes the attempt. The heal comes out. There's the Q. Ocelot might want a taste on this one. There is a flash for Lee Sin, but he is far enough away that he's not going to get it in time. Red team, Unicorns of Love, slay the dragon. They're up 2,000 gold.
Yuki is going to take some damage here. He's got to back off.
Alrighty, Unicorns of Love, they salvaged that bot lane. They've remained within about 20 minions down there as this Corki goes towards Triforce. Gilius jumped on by Morden. No flash required. There it is, actually.
Go straight forward. Visichachi, though. Getting the short end of the stick
to get back in. And he didn't need it for Dragon, so heck, there's not even much of a penalty if you flash, if you teleport here.
That's true. Gilius still in sight. These wards that two have decided to put down all over the jungle are paying off for them. Early Bilgewater Cutlass again for Gilius.
Ooh, Ocelot though. Nice sweep on the ward and says, you know what, I guess I can't roam top just yet. He could have looked for the dive on Visichachi. Gilius back in base, no flash. Does go early cooldown boots off to the Cutlass. Very attack damage focus. Ocelot takes a really bad trade to the face. Look at this damage of Power of Evil. 3 ults in a row, force the ulti out of Ocelot. Wow, some pretty good damage.
Wow, so the AP Kog'Maw mid just bullying around the Lulu now, and wave clearing.
Yeah, but not early. I mean, blue buff Lulu as well doesn't really miss CS anymore, so
Well, here's the thing, too, is also there aren't any real combat stats on Power of Evil. He's got some mana regen. He's got some magic resistance, just very minimal. Then he has the two Dorans.
Yep.
Right? So aside from those, he's really got nothing. He's got no AP. And here comes the counter game.
Chachi getting jumped on. Great kick by Morden. Does claim the kill. Nicely done. Now Gilly's got to be real careful. Sapling slows him down. Morden's still in the hunt, though. In comes Kog'Maw. And they will not chase that, but a one for none. Good job, G2.
Yeah, you can't chase that when you see that AP Kog'Maw Power of Evil coming from mid lane. He has Ghost, he has Flash, he has a lot of ways to get to you, and the bottom turret's actually going to drop and bring the gold within about 600 of each other.
All right, and life remains happy then. These two pulling their way back in. This bot lane should still be this place of power for them. 20 minion lead. Infinity Edge done soon. Problem is Corki is spiked above with the Triforce being done. Rydal's got to be a little bit careful.
Still gonna go for this on Hillisang.
Just stay all right.
The trades that keep happening bottom though is usually a hook onto Hillisang and then some damage on it, and then at the same time Vardax hits Yuki, and it's not an even trade to damage on the support for the AD carry. It's what it looks like it keeps happening back and forth.
Yeah, it's really true.
Oh, that's a hook on Bardock, though. He's going to go in on this one. Plays him back, boxes him, but Hillisang going to block all of Yuki's damage. There's a jump into the back line. Teleport's going to be used as well. Nice double knockup and Rydal. One hit from dead, not quite going to die. Finally trades that one back, just maybe.
Oh,
no,
die.
The play's going to happen. JWoww took down the AD carry. Hillisang going to rejoin the team, but JWoww going to make this one happen as Yuki takes down Hillisang as well. Now Vizachachi forced to run away. Morden forces a flash for his Q. That is a 2-0 for Gamers 2.
Exactly, a 2-0 for Gamers 2 to come out on top of that one. Really big play there, and the fact that those wards were actually slammed down at the same time, I believe, to allow the TP to come in. I know that Rydal threw one down just for the TP. It was communicated.
Beautiful stuff then, Gamers 2. And look how often Morden keeps going into this jungle camp. He warded that, and it looks for Gilius time. And again, no flash available. Has the ulti. Is it going to be enough, though? Lots of reveals from Lee Sin. Kicks him back in. That's going to happen. Morden taking him down in his own jungle.
Uses an ultimate for his ultimate. Wasn't quite an escape there for Gilius. And now there's a lot of pressure they can exert on this mid lane.
So three kills just swung in Gamers 2 favor. Actually, they've gotten four in a row overall. And look how good this looks for G2. They're up 1,000 gold. They're forcing people to run around the map, defending whatever they can. But this is looking great. This Lee Sin invading the jungle, making plays. Morden is doing great.
Every time you play against a Rengar, we said it multiple times today, you gotta go bully him in his jungle. His escapes are very, very limited.
Yeah.
Really hard for Rengar to get away from you. Even his ultimate is not a surefire escape or even close to one.
So, back goes Unicorns of Love. They are only 500 gold down though, and I feel like team fights are their forte here. They can put themselves in a good spot. They've got that Maokai who is doing very well in the top lane. JWoww is holding up in CS. This turret is nearly dead. The knockup fails, but JWoww is forced to CS.
And now Morden coming up top again. JWoww, 1-0-3. He's doing really well for himself. Vizachachi goes for the check.
He's going to land. Knockup is there. The ward comes out, but the root lasted too long. Morden couldn't get in on that one. Vizachachi stays safe.
And Morden just applying some damage, and JWoww has really tipped this matchup with his extra kills.
See this turret, they're losing health pretty quickly. Power of Evil brought that down to about a quarter overall. Also looks to rejoin the team. More poke comes down. It looks like Unicorns of Love actually forced Ocelot off this turret for a short time. Minions are gone. This could be a turret kill.
Gilius coming in from the side. He's ready to apply more damage to this turret with his team. And that's going to be turret to UOL. Dragon in 40 seconds, and they have ward control of that area.
But what matters is what kind of items come through, because you've got Zeal and almost a lot of the way towards Shiv for Yuki right now. He's pretty powerful. We haven't seen a buy from Corki in a little while. Top lane turret does go down to Vizachachi. There's actually a lot these guys could buy, but Dragon's up in 25.
There's no TPs on these top laners. They're going to have to book it to Dragon pretty much right now if they want to even be a part of this fight. Hook onto Vardax.
Oh, they do go in the flay, the box, everything, but Vardax flashes out. Morden cannot quite chase, but they still kill Hillisong. 10 seconds till Dragon and Gamers 2 own that side of the map.
That is the playmaking that they brought Rydal on to execute, and he's doing it perfectly this series. Are they going to get more for this?
Oh my gosh, they really might. Flash forced away. Now can AP Cog force Gamers 2 out? He's doing some good damage. Rydal losing a bit of health, but Dragon has been started. Gilius wants in. He does not have Flash. JWoww gets the top turret as well. UOL are trying. They do force off Dragon.
But here's the thing, is that JWoww is top split pushing, doing what Aurelius should do against Maokai, but Maokai is in this fight. It is essentially an even fight here without the presence of the person that UOL lost, Hillisung, and without the presence of JWoww. So it's a 4-on-4.
But both teams are coming down now. You can see JWoww cutting through the mid lane, the AD carrying support coming down as well. Unicorns of Love do stop the dragon, but they still lost, what, two kills? Or one kill and a top lane turret overall.
Rydal and Warden just both backed right now. So they're going to have to buy time here on Gamers 2 side if they want anything to do with this dragon. Unicorns of Love trying to make a move for it.
Here we go, dragon losing a lot of health pretty rapidly. The support and jungler are gone, so UOL will claim this dragon, but the fight might ensue afterwards. Good smite there by Gilius. Unicorns of Love stay 400 gold ahead. Now, can they disengage though? Gamers 2 looks like they want something here. Q lands. Nothing done.
Nothing done, and Gamers 2 give up that dragon, mostly because JWoww opted for the turret top instead of coming into that fight way earlier than that.
And he didn't have teleports, only coming up right now. And that was the price they pay. Close game here in Game 3. Gamers 2 keep finding ways to get kills, and that is a very scary thing when you're UOL.
It is tense. It is extremely tense in both camps. 600 gold divides these two teams right now. Any team fight could really make or break this game and snowball and just completely devastate one team's hopes at getting into the LCS.
Yeah, they could. So, what is the focus for these teams? I still think Unicorns of Love want just the dedicated, direct team fight. They've got siege power. They've got the Cog ulti. They've got saplings. They've got quirky rockets. When someone engages on, they've got the counter engage from Braum, the Maokai. 5-on-5, exactly what Unicorns of Love want. G2, though, honestly, looking for picks. Yeah, the split push, split your team apart, make things happen with Aurelia, make things happen with Thresh, follow up with Lulu.
Yeah, the fact that JWoww is doing so well for himself, 1-0-3 against Vizichachi, the 0-1-0 Maokai, I think that's a huge boon for the team. He can go ahead and continue to push the top lane, or he can just out-rotate him, especially since he's stronger.
Yeah, I mean, look at JWoww's build, too. He gets the Spectre's Cowl just to tank damage a little bit, but he's going right for Zephyr here on Aurelia to really break through and deal damage to Vizichachi here. Extra attack speed, extra attack damage. It's a great offensive item for Aurelia. And that might be G2 finding a way in if he can win these fights. Gilius, no ulti just yet. He's level 11 here, outleveled by Morden. Hillisong tanks up the culling, doesn't take too much damage for it. Minions stay cleared by AP Cog. Morden, good ward control to try to own the top jungle.
Really want to keep an eye on this top lane matchup, because I think that's what's going to just sway this game, is what does JWoww do, and how does Vizichachi react to it, and vice versa. Because JWoww went for a turret instead of dragon there. If he keeps doing that, eventually he'll either be knocking on inhibitors, or the dragon will just be too much gold for the team. It's a back and forth there. Power Beeble. He also just got one of his defensive options with the completion of his Seraph's Embrace. So now he's going to be a little bit tankier in a fight, just if he can actually hit that ability. But now, JWoww versus Vizichachi, this is the fight, and it's happening in both spots.
Oh, the mid lane's going down so fast. Hillisong cannot even ult in time. That is a kill picked up for nothing.
Wow, and at the same time, Vizichachi, less than half HP. He's forced to stay under the turret with basically no resources available.
Final, the matchup is won by the Aurelia pushing in towards the top lane tier 2. Vizichachi basically no
help. Oh my god.
Flashes away. JWoww gets the kill underneath the turret, but here comes Gilius. Can he flip this one around? Lands a bit of a slow. Spells come down. No root's going to come through though. Look at that. Suddenly, Gamers 2 have broken their way in. Gilius in a really bad spot. Stun's going to land. First comes out. Kill picked up by Morden. Now, Asa's got to be careful. Get the lantern out. Safe.
They've also broken the curse of Vizichachi being the survivor every fight. There, we saw JWoww just flash in and say, nope, no more for you. No more near deaths. Duels him under turret, he gets rooted up. He misses his last one because it's flashed, but then he flashed Blade Surges to just pick up the kill at the very end.
Man, how late was that Maokai ulti as well? Visichachi didn't block almost any damage with that one. And Unicorns of Love falling victim to the fact that gamers too have repeatedly found these one-on-one or two-on-one kills, the hooks, the Irelia 1v1s, all that working for gamers too. The jungle ganks from Morden also better, 3-0-0. Gilius just has not found the engages on Rengar.
Illisang is gonna get caught again.
Forced to flash for that one. The wave clear still fine for power reveal, but the problem is they're not just fighting 5-on-5 center turrets. They're getting picked off in random places.
Yeah, and in the top lane we see Visichachi. He's gonna go for the split push here, and JWoww is actually with the team already.
Gamers 2 trying to make the siege work, trying to dodge away from all the freaking Kog'Maw artillery. Let's see if it's gonna be enough. Look at that, G2 just can't stay in it. Caster minions get one shot by the E. I think melees take basically one R to die afterwards.
Yeah, an E and an R, and the wave is completely cleared, and the range of that wave clear is really big. There's no fall off too, so if you stand inside of any of those, you're still gonna take full damage.
Yeah, it's good 400 or 500 health. Lost by people. Chachi kills a pink ward. Now Rengar has ulti. 300 gold difference is basically nothing.
Drag it up in 25 seconds.
Look at this. JWoww splitting top with teleport. Visichachi gonna be slow on making his way up there. Banshee's Veil completed for JWoww, just sitting on the pickaxe still. I've seen that pickaxe so many times. We've seen this, like, we've seen so many stop at pickaxe Aurelius.
Yeah, they'll sit on the pickaxe. Sometimes they turn it into Zephyr.
Yeah. I feel like it's a breakpoint thing. Because it happens so often that they don't finish Zephyr, they just stop at pickaxe.
Yeah, I was like, it goes into Zephyr, right?
Yeah, it does build into Zephyr. Which is strange because it's so frequent.
That brain fart there.
Yeah, no, it's fine. You've been trained to not think about the item anymore, I understand.
Yeah. I don't know where I could have possibly been trained. Oh, Power of Evil's hooked.
There's the hook. He does flash away, but the box comes down. Rydal in the front lines, and now Bardogs cannot get away from JWoww. Gets the kill, and now he comes into the back line as well. Hillsong forced to run away. The chase on Visichachi, though, and down goes the tree. They trade back and forth, though, as the Thresh goes down. Morden wants Gilius. There's the Glitter Lancer, and that is a third kill now for Gamers 2.
And are they going to go for the dragon, or are they going to go for a turret? They might even just get both.
Oh, man. Here comes Morden and Ocelot for this one. Does get away from the sapling, and JWoww plus Yuki will take the mid lane outer turret as well. Only Kog'Maw here to defend. Wave, they're gonna be decent. Yuki forced a dash away, but that is dragon and mid lane outer turret. Gamers 2 now snowballing a bit of a lead here, almost 4,000 gold ahead. They keep winning every single battle. That was an actual team fight too for UOL, but man, did they blow up that back line.
This is, once again, Rydal, making a play right here. He gets the flash out of Power of Evil, and then JWoww gets Bardax's flash. He gets him completely from 100-0, and then the rest of the team is just there to clean it up. Rydal, being completely selfless, sacrifices himself for the good of the team and the good of the play. That is the type of player that Rydal is. And he looks like a fantastic fit for Gamers 2 coming off of these series. Like, more often than not, he will be making a good play for his team.
Yes, he will be. It's gotten better and better with that player. Gamers 2 looking to be the team that makes it into the semifinals here in this Game 3. Winner faces H2K, who's waiting for them in the semis, as the second seed of the tournament overall. We already know SK Prime will face Ninjas in Pajamas. It looks like Gamers 2 will face H2K, and three of those four teams just mentioned will be making the Spring 2015 promotion tournament in just a few weeks.
I don't know how much I'd count UOL out of the equation just yet, because they are only 3.4k gold behind.
Now, if they can make their way in, that'd be great for them, but they're running out of options here. They haven't seemed to find a way to break down the JWoww split push. He's got a Hex Drinker now. He doesn't even take damage from Visichachi anymore.
He might be going for a Maw, and it was just an early pickaxe for that.
All the crazy things you could do. Watch, he wants another pickaxe. He's like, I'll finish these later.
Just more.
25 more attack damage.
He's a miner, leave him alone.
He's only 16. JWoww. Uh-oh, gets jumped on by Gilius in the brush, and here comes Corki as well, but he is baiting as the team takes down Baron Nashor. JWoww does fall down, but look at the health bar, down to half HP, but they're forced to disengage. Good ward over the wall by Hillisong. UOL finally do get that pick they needed.
So I guess the answer to the question, what are they going to do about JWoww, is they're going to walk up there and just kill him. Seems to be a good strategy. Seems to be working effectively to stop the Baron, too.
Well, that's the problem with split pushing top lane when you're looking for a Baron. You've got to split push the bottom lane, pull the enemy team all the way away. Easy to capitalize on stopping the Baron there for that one. And Gamers 2 playing the back foot now for 20 seconds here.
And also a big thing about that is if you're pushing the bottom lane, you do need your teleport available to make the catch with me too. If you deal with me, then I go TP. Mm-hmm. If you can't deal with me fast enough, or if you don't deal with me at all, I push turrets and then I TP it later. Like, always having that option is good, because if the TP is down, you give you way more options. They can four-man kill your team at Baron, pick up the Baron for themselves,
yep.
And then they can come in. Maybe they'll lose a turret, but it's worth it at that point.
And right now, Unicorns of Love, I do want to... You're right to not discount them, by the way. That pick was really good, but also I feel like they have better late game. They have a Feral Flare Rengar who is starting to go tanky finally, which means he will be more and more difficult to remove, and actually more and more damaging as time goes on. AP Cog is a notoriously good late game champion. Void Staff already done. Deathcap, I believe, is next.
Here's the thing, though, is Yuki on that Lucian is actually really, really good late game, and the fact he's 3-0 and 4 sets him up for that perfectly.
Indeed it does, but...
First pick of him. Paying off.
That's true, and he's doing really well. Obviously, 3-0-4. The problem is, we've seen how hard it is to remove Maokai. Yeah. Maokai is slightly behind the curve, but he is not that far from Randuin's. When that item comes through, Yuki's life becomes pretty hard in removing him.
Yeah, his multi-armor build here. I mean, I guess that is the correct way to go here, because he wouldn't be dealing too much with Ocelot's damage, because Lulu's damage isn't so persistent.
Yeah.
It's more of the Irelia.
And it's multiple attacks we shoot as well.
Exactly.
Again, for the Irelia. Randuin's plus Frozen Heart. Really going to make killing him difficult. And there we can see Blue Elixir, not Blue Buff. Power of Evil is trying to harass, but look at this. Irelia making her way to the top lane. Has teleport, basically.
Lich Bane completed for Ocelot. He's ready to push some turrets. But look at this. Unicorns of Love. Trying to get some vision control of this area around the Baron. And JWoww, he's back to pushing top with his TP.
That's where you want to be as Irelia.
They're doing a pretty good job of avoiding the poke here from on Gamers 2 side. They haven't really fallen prey to the chunk downs of the bio or the living artillery. It is bio, but you.
Hillisong in the brush. Here's the TP. Ocelot does not get locked up. A great lantern out. No Glacial Fissure going to do anything, but uh-oh. It's actually JWoww on the other side of the map, and Gilius is going to jump out as well. He is going to survive just barely, and the Q is going to miss as well, but the fight continues now. Vizachachi in the front line, taking up so much damage. Hillisong survives as well, and now Morden wants to re-engage. Lands the Q, goes in on Vizachachi, but Morden just gets exploded now. Vizachachi finally does go down. One for one, jungle for top lane. Yuki goes in, but the unbreakable shield keeps him alive.
Yeah, Morden getting a little over-eager there. They needed his health bar in that fight more than they needed it chasing down Gilius. Big problem there, and a little bit of a misplay on his part, I would say. The fact that there was actually a hook onto Vardags and pulling him around and actually keeping him CC'd, and they didn't capitalize on it.
Yeah. But you saw just how much damage Power of Evil could do right there. Broke down Morden, and suddenly Magic Resist is an incredibly important stat here. Vardags thankfully did go for a attack damage build. I think he should have gone Zerk Greaves instead of Sork Shoes, but the fact that he has an Infinity Edge now means he is set up to do a lot of physical damage in fights when G2 are going to be adding E4 MR. There's the Maw of Immortus, as you pointed out. Spectre's Cowl is up now for Morden as well. Another Negatron Cloak picked up for Rydal. MR is the item of the day here. No armor items literally at all picked up for Gamers 2, and Vardox is slowly catching up.
Yep. Not even one. Not even a Ninja Tabby. Now Gamers 2. Sidetracked to the Dragon. Rest of the Unicorns of Love off on the side.
Look how fast it goes.
They might
kill
Baron.
Dragon falling. I don't think they can kill Baron in time, though. Kog'Maw stuck in base. Corki recalling back.
They can deny the vision. They can set up for it. They might be able to make a pick. But the fact that not everybody is there is a big problem.
Gonna get it done, though.
Now Gamers 2 establish the ward control.
Yeah, they are. Rydell clearing wards while dodging artillery. Doing a good job of that one. I believe Power of Evil has his blue buff again now. Not gonna J-Wave the dodge. He wants this fight. He just goes on in. Who cares about anything else? Gilius goes in. He wants Yuki. And they dive on him. Down he goes. Vardox gets killed by J-Wave. They trade 80 carries. And the battle continues with Vezichachi. He's going to be very tanky. And Power of Evil deals some pretty good damage. They root up more than one hit from dead. The flash from Hillisong. Don't know if he needed a flash for that one, but they will pick him up. That is now a 3-for-1. And Unicorns of Love are in on Baron.
They just went straight in on Yuki and they blew him up. And that's a huge problem. He is the most fed member on the team. And he is the persistent damage threat that they want. The utility wasn't there. He wasn't alive long enough, and now they get a Baron for it, but they trade that middle turret. So Gamers 2, they kind of come out even in it, but the temporary combat stats for Unicorns of Love and the Baron on top.
Yeah, there was no peel for him. I did not see Thresh play and went backwards. I did not see the ulti come out from Ocelot, and I didn't see Morden kick anybody back either. Yes, they traded Vardogs back in, but look at the disparity between those two champions. You can see it in the kill score, you can see it in the CS, you can see it in the items. Trading 80 carries is so good for Unicorns of Love, and Vizichachi can't die when that happens.
Yeah, and Vizichachi, like I said, the persistent damage that you need is that 80 carry to just chunk him down, get him out of the fight. See here, the flank in is perfect. Vizichachi comes in with the damage reduction and tries to set up his team. They see the culling and it's like, oh, locked on, auto target that. They go straight after Yuki, crit backwards. And JWoww, he ends up trading it, but look at this. Power of Evil the entire time is throwing fire arcane barrage shots, living artillery, and his caustic spill over the wall.
That was Unicorns of Love making such a better choice, too. Yuki was stranded by his team. They all rushed the red buff, not thinking about the fact that Rengar could be coming in from behind. Yuki had nobody near him, and so smart by UOL. Vizichachi just dives in, says, yep, I'm going to lock these guys up. They will be doing battle with me. You guys go kill Yuki. They did it so well. Unicorns of Love still down 1,400 gold, but they are right back in this game.
Yep, and they have those temporary combat stats. So right now, in a 5-on-5 teamfight, they are definitely stronger than Gamers 2, especially if they make it to Yuki like they just did.
And now JWoww with very few tank items, just the Banshee's Veil and the Maw. He is going to try to do what he can to the back line. You're going to wave through the mid lane. Worked pretty well, but Hillisong tanks a lot of it there, and that means the mid lane tier 2 turret is going to go down. Unicorns of Love now with their 4th turret kill. The gold back within 600 now. Minions still falling, and now onto the inhibitor they go.
This is a huge, huge thing. Unicorns of Love, they're going to get the first inhibitor of the game, possibly. It is a 5-on-5. Everybody's up. Warden looking around the side.
But Ocelot is almost dead already.
Wow.
The artillery push him out of the battle. 5-on-4. He buys home guards, but they're going for the inhibitor already.
Morden, he's looking for a flank. He's being zoned off by Hillisong.
Banshee's Veil's gone as well, which means it can be peeled even easier. Yuki is there with his 4th completed item. He's, again, an item up on Vardogs. If he gets to deal damage, he'll deal a lot.
If they can make it to that range, though, they want this inhibitor. They're trying to go after it.
Wow, ulti used again just for some poke. Hillisong tanks it up with the shield. JWoww is slowed. There's the engage for Vizichachi. The battle has begun. Ulti's popped all around. The knockups are there, and they bring down Vardogs. Now can these guys kite away? JWoww gets locked up one more time. He will fall 1-for-1 so far, and Yuki forced to kite away. He has stayed up. He flashes out. Still the 1-for-1. Now Hillisong being slowed. Inhibitor goes down, but Hillisong likely to pay for it with his life. The hook's going to land from Rydell. 2-for-1 Gamers 2, but that is still a dead inhibitor.
And they get some of the Baron buffs off of these members of Unicorns of Love, but there's just so much damage from Power of Evil there. Yuki was not expecting that burst on him, and he actually was forced to flash away. Gonna rush straight up the middle.
Yeah, they get a lot of pressure for this. I mean, while these guys are grabbing the blue buff, I think you can still get it. Yeah, but actually,
Kog'Maw
of Evil might be cut off. I don't know if they know where he is though. They ping it. They know where he is. Ocelot's chasing. Power of Evil's gonna ghost. Nice E to slow them down. Ooh. Ocelot cannot reach anymore. Goes around the side. He's waiting for a long time because Vizichachi is coming. Can they get this fight to go in their favor? The Q shred's going to miss, but Rydell is locked up. Vizichachi is a very, very durable tree. The Banshee's Veil gonna be blocked out. Morden's gonna kick him back on the team. They just wanna focus down on this top laner, but he is not dying fast at all. He's gonna be able to walk away from this one very, very safe.
That's how you Maokai.
Yeah.
Keep that ultimate on you for as long as you possibly can. That's the whole reason you buy so much mana on.
He makes it out. Gamers 2 forces pick up the scraps of the various waves around the map. Unicorns of Love. They have minions pushing in the mid lane. They will have time to play the rest of the map. Dragon should be theirs. Their red buff should be theirs. To be honest, they should probably keep pushing.
Yeah. It's true. They're going to give this red buff over to Fardax. Yuki, the highest DPS member on his team, is trying to do work for it, but he's still very squishy. If he eats a Void Ooze, he gets chunked to about half HP. It is hitting for a disgusting amount right now.
Well, especially because it comes out of his stomach.
Yeah,
it's gross.
Disgusting.
Ugh.
Yeah.
Seriously.
665 AP on that Kog'Maw. No Nashor's Tooth. He's not even going for a hybrid auto attack build. He's going straight, just chunk your face.
Yep.
AP.
And here they go for the bot lane.
I wonder how much he's actually played this, or if he's just like, Faker did it.
I'm sure he's played it a little bit.
Faker did it.
Because he plays with the Jolly Champion. Xerath, right, really big in his pool. The AP Kog'Maw just kind of the second rendition of that one. Here they go in. Damage going down onto this turret. Hook's not going to... Oh, it's going to hit for the Chachi, actually. The front line is in the front.
It
goes right
over.
He wants to kill tanks. That's not good for him. He's going to go down. For the Chachi still alive with shields. This could be the fight for Unicorns of Love. JWoww's going to go down. Three kills picked up for UOL.
They just killed three of their members. They're going to get this turret for themselves, or they're just going to push up down that mid lane. There are 58 seconds on members of Gamers 2.
50 seconds on the respawn. Dive in for the mid lane. Just remove the minions. Don't even have to, maybe even. They could just backdoor these turrets. In comes the front line. The TP, full health from Bizachachi.
This is desperation for Gamers 2. If they lose this match, if they lose their Nexus, it is over for them, and they have to try and requalify in multiple months from now.
And here we go. Turret everyone under attack. Bizachachi in the front lines. They're going to kill off Morden. It's now a 1v5. Ocelot cannot do it by himself. Turret number 2 goes down. Nexus under fire. This is going to be the game. Unicorns of Love keep the dream alive, and they are into the semifinals.
And they're going to be up against H2K, a team that, granted, by what I just saw from Unicorns of Love, they look really damn good right now.
Yes.
In terms of their objective control, their ward control, and their team fighting. Also, their champion select is right where it needs to be for a challenger team. They know what they prioritize, they know what they want, and it just all around, it's a fantastic team that we haven't seen enough of in the challenger series,
yeah,
considering they keep running into NIP, which maybe they'll run into NIP in the finals.
Finals or third place. You never know which way it's going to go. Maybe they dodge them completely.
Yeah.
One could lose. Who even knows in this one? But this now means that Unicorns of Love are in the top 4. You need to make top 3, though. So they still have a road ahead of them. They've got to win one of their next 2 best of 3s to make the promotion tournament. Same with any team here in the semifinals there. But you got to hand it to them. They started the game like 2-13 in kills. And I was like, Gamers 2 are getting close. They're doing really good things. And UOL started turning it on.
Told you not to count them out.
I didn't count them out. I just said, hey, this is a thing that is happening. I just want to point out, this game ends with Gamers 2 up 15-13 in kills. But what did flip was that assist score. I think it's really fun to call back to. Gamers 2, 15 kills, 30 assists. Basically, 2 assists per kill, 3 members involved. That's a decent score. But for UOL, 13 kills, 40 assists. 3 assists per kill. Basically, when they were winning, the entire team was involved. They have the Maokai. They have the Braum. It is a team fight composition. That is what they wanted. Those are the types of fights they got. Group up for the Dragon. Group up for the Baron. If you see Yuki by himself, that Rengar's going for him, and he's going to pick him off, and you lock up the rest of the team. The fact they had a big freaking tank that couldn't quite get killed, at the end of the day, that's what mattered.
Yeah, the frontliner, Vizachachi, we saw him play that Maokai game 2. Mm. Game 3, they don't pick it up. First rotation for Gamers 2. They go with the Lucian.
And it's just lane.
Such a big, beefy tank. And the fact of Maokai is, even if you get behind, you're still going to complete and do your job in team fights. You're basically a Mundo where it's like, eh, I lost lane, but I show up, throw cleavers, CC people, and then run around and soak a lot of abilities.
Yeah, you do provide some base utility. I think you still do have to be relevant in the item gain, because all you're ever doing in that champion is multiplying your existing items. It's not free. It's a multiplier.
Yes.
So you do have to be a little bit careful there, but it has worked out for Vizachachi. Held up in his lane. The Irelia lost to the Maokai all 3 times. You got to consider, is that really a counter pick here?
Yep.
Because
I have no clue.
It has not paid out in the team fight so far.
What I've been hearing.
Yep, so well done on the team fights there. Now that all of today's quarterfinal series are in our match history, let's take a look at the updated challenger bracket. Tomorrow's semifinals will feature the number one seed Ninjas in Pajamas going up against SK Prime, and a rematch, of course, of the Summer 2 Finals.
And the other best of three match is the Summer 1 champion, H2K Gaming, against Unicorns of Love.
So those two best of three matches take place beginning at 5 p.m. Central European Summertime, 8 a.m. Pacific Daylight Time, so set your alarms right now. And we're calling it here, we're calling it a day here in California, but before we go, I want to say thanks again to our friends at Coca-Cola. On behalf of myself, Zyrene, the entire live broadcast crew, thanks for watching, good night, and GG. Jungle camp. He warded that, and it looks for Gilius. Time and again, no flash available. Has the ulti. Is it going to be enough, though? Lots of reveals from Lee Sin. Kicks him back in. That's going to happen. And now he comes into the back line as well. Hillsong forced to run away. The chase on Visichachi, though. And down goes the tree. They trade back and forth, though, as the Thresh goes down. Borden wants Gilius. There's the Glittolancer. That is a third kill now for Gamers 2. Visichachi wants this fight. He just goes on in. Who cares about anything else? Gilius goes in. He wants Yuki. And they dive on him. Down he goes. Vardogs gets killed by Jaywa. They trade 80 carries. The front line is in the front. It goes right over, but he wants to kill tanks. That's not good for him. He's going to go down. Visichachi still alive with shields. This could be the fight for Unicorns of Love. JWoww is going to go down. Three kills picked up for UOL.